So this is Patrick, a very happy young man. And he loves a great day at the fair. He enjoys the carousel. He wants to listen to the music. He's also a very social person, and he wants to meet people. He wants to touch them. He wants to hug them. Sometimes Patrick also is very vulnerable, and that's because of his severe intellectual disability. And because of that, he cannot speak. He cannot express his emotions by voice. And because of that, because of his severe intellectual disability, he lives in a care institution in the Netherlands, in Veldhoven. And he gets 24-hour support for all aspects in his life. And as a volunteer, I know Patrick already for a long time. And about 7 years ago, after a day activity with his relatives, he came back and his relative said, yeah, he was not feeling okay. He was a bit angry. He was showing discomfort. And then at home, his pajama was put on, shoes were removed. And then he was again the happy Patrick. And we saw a joyful face. And then we started to think, how come? How come that he was not feeling well that whole day, a bit angry, showing discomfort, challenging behavior, as we call that. And after removing shoes, he was Patrick again. And then we discovered that his wrinkling shoe caused pain and that he was not able to express that, tell the relatives, the environment, that he was suffering from pain. And that was a kind of eureka moment for me to think of a solution that could give him a voice. And we could think of technology, of sensor technology, but also artificial intelligence that could give him a voice. And that was actually the start of developing the U. Now, Patrick is not the only one with challenging behavior. The Netherlands give home to more than 140,000 people with an intellectual disability. And many of them do have a severe intellectual disability with challenging behavior. And challenging behavior is not providing comfort. It's not providing quality of life. If you are not understood, then people cannot give the proper help and proper needs that someone needs. So it's not contributing to quality of life. And at the same time, challenging behavior can escalate into incidents. So escalations can really harm the person himself, but also the environment. And that will lead to dropout and burnout of care professionals. So also by better understanding emotions and challenging behavior, we could save costs, a lot of costs. And so therefore, we believe that providing a voice, literally a voice by sensor technology and artificial intelligence, we provide better care, provide more quality of life, and also reduce costs of care. So how does it work? So if you feel stress or if you feel angry, then your body responds. So your body response is a kind of measure for the emotion that you feel. Most probably everyone knows that if you are angry or are mad, that your heart rate increases. Or if you feel scared, that you start to sweat. Now, this is the kind of response that we also measure to identify stress in people that cannot communicate themselves. And then you are wondering, so, okay, but if I have an intensive activity like running or soccer, then also your heart rate increases and you start to sweat. So we need to distinguish between what we call fiscal stress and mental stress. And for that, we need artificial intelligence. We need trained models that could provide this information. So this is actually what we did. So we invited over 150 people in a test laboratory, and we exposed these people to emotions. And then we took a model that describes emotions on two different scales. One scale is the intensity. That's what we call the arousal level. And the other scale is what we call the valence, if a positive or negative emotion is felt. And then we expose these people to horror movies, to very friendly movies, to mathematical exercises, to frustration exercises. And with that, we could prompt all kinds of emotions in these people. And at the same time, we invite these participants to annotate their own feelings on the scales I just indicated, arousal and the valence. And based on that, we obtained a labeled data set that we could use to train an artificial intelligence model, what we call a kind of deep learning model. And with that labeled data set, we were able to provide an 80% balanced accuracy, which means that in 80% of the cases, we predict stress, and also in 80% of the cases, we predict a kind of relaxation. Then we had to apply that to realistic cases. And for that, we have set up a validation study with 10 care institutions in the Netherlands, with over 25 participants with challenging behavior. And we did, of course, not expose them to emotions, but we were observing. We were observing emotions in daily life. And during these events, people showed some challenging behavior, but also relaxed moments. In addition to collecting the physiology, so the measurements of the heart rate and the skin conductance, we also did video observations, and we invited the psychologists and personal caregivers, so people that knew these clients very well, to annotate also the events that we collected. And based on that labeled data set, we also obtained an 80% balanced accuracy. And that means that in 80% of the cases, we can predict stress development, and also we can predict relaxed moments. And if you convert that to escalations, then 4 out of 5 escalations were then seen by the system, by the human system. So that's excellent. So we have a tool in hand that can help to better understand the development of stress. And then we had to convert that to a realistic case. We had to make a sensor device that can be integrated in the care practice, in daily practice. So for that, we developed a sock, a smart sock that could measure the skin conductance underneath the food. So if you have sweaty hands, you also have most probably sweaty feet. And this is the best place to measure skin response. And that's the response to all kinds of emotions. So this this was one wearable that we had to develop, and also we are using at this moment. So the sensor collects the data real time and converts that to the cloud with a sensor device. And at the same time, we are measuring the heart rate with a patch on the chest, and we do the same. We also send that information to the cloud, and then with the trained models, we can convert that into stress signals. Now, the stress signal is then seen by the caregiver on the smartphone. The smartphone is then a kind of tool to support the caregiver with this identification of stress. And then we have two functions. One function is the function of early warning, and that the caregiver sees the increase of stress as a traffic light. And once the traffic light goes from green to orange, there's a kind of signaling for the caregiver to step in, to provide an intervention, or to change the environment in which the client is at that moment living. The other function that we developed is a diagnostics function, and that you try to understand behavior or the feelings of someone that is exposed to a challenging situation or a kind of discomfort situation. And in this way, you can investigate what contributes to the quality of life or what doesn't contribute to the quality of life of that person. So at this moment, we have integrated the system in 20 care institutions in the Netherlands. So we are applying the smart sock and the chest patch for real-time data collection. And at this moment, people really experience more quality of life because we change day structure, we change care plans, and we also change how we interact with people. So by developing this system, we have given Patrick literally a voice. And this voice is now used to better understand him, to provide more quality of life in his very vulnerable life. And at the same time, we believe that it's also a very nice tool for the caregiver to avoid dropout and burnout. So we have helped Patrick with this technology and this tool. And I all invite you to also think of a relative that could benefit from this technology. Thanks for your attention.